You should know by now that Ramsay doesn't take shit. Full stop. But this contestant, who thought it would be a great idea to try and teach him some manners, got a taste of their own medicine. And that's just one of the times that Ramsay destroyed the chefs on Hell's Kitchen. Do you remember this moment from season 5?
Who's cooked the diapers?
Well, that would be Colleen, aka Miss Manners. You see, when it comes to Colleen, it wasn't just the dishes she made that were full of shit. The contestant, who hails from the state of Nebraska, revealed something interesting about herself. She claimed that she worked as a culinary instructor, teaching others how to cook. And guess what? Those classes didn't come cheap. No, those ran at 300 bucks a pop. By the sound of it, we've got a pro cook here, who would easily give the others a run for their money. And just when I thought she was gonna stun Ramsay with some brilliant cooking skills, she dropped a bomb.
And were you a trained chef before you set up the school?
No, I am not a trained chef.
Yep, Colleen had never taken up professional training in any way, shape, or form. Yeah. And here I was, naively thinking that culinary school was a prerequisite for such exalted feats. Ah, silly me. But you know what? It's not her charging that atrocious amount that gets me, but rather that people willingly paid for those lessons. Well, I guess Colleen's students had no idea about her little secret until this particular episode aired. Anyway, let's cut to the moment of truth. Ramsay's response to her dish wasn't exactly what she anticipated. But before that, here's another hilarious moment that transpired between Ramsay and the so-called culinary instructor.
Colleen.
Yeah, leave it to Ramsay to put people in their place without even saying much. Anyway, he had to have been taken aback by the size of the dish and even went on to criticize its taste. I mean, take a look at this.
Craig?
You seriously charge $300?
Ouch. That pride of hers must have been taken down a peg or two, and Colleen felt pretty insulted about it. And nope, she didn't back down. She had the gall to talk back to him.
I teach manners too, chef.
Excuse me, ma'am. Maybe what you need is a lesson in humility. Anyway, I genuinely thought Ramsay was gonna chew her out. But you know, I think he went way too easy on her here.
Okay, please, Miss Manners, off back in line.
What's more, her so-called professional lessons left Ramsay tongue-tied during her first dinner service. She was assigned to the appetizer section with G, and her main deal was getting that risotto on point. But things didn't go as planned.
Mascarpone cream cheese in the spaghetti of lobster!
And then, something unexpected happened. The lights went out and Hell's Kitchen was thrown into darkness. Well, only for a few seconds, anyway. Who knew Hell's Kitchen wasn't immune to power outages? Once the lights were back on, Ramsay caught Colleen doing something dirty. The kind that's absolutely blasphemous in his kitchen.
You're starting a fresh one in a dirty pan?
Yes, chef.
Oh.
Yeah, she was using dirty, unwashed pans to plate her fresh pasta. And that's when, surprise, surprise, Ramsay unveiled a stack of clean pans that she had conveniently chosen to ignore. Not a good look, Colleen, I'll tell you that much. Well, that wasn't the end of it. As the service continued, she ran into even more problems. First, she was cooking an excessive amount of spaghetti, like just way too much. Ramsay pointed out that it was unnecessary and would just slow everything down. Later, Ramsay discovered pasta in the trash. Like, talk about overcorrecting. And don't even get me started on how disrespectful it was of the kitchen's resources.
And there's more down here as well. You put it in the bin.
However, her struggles continued. 2.5 hours into the service, she finally managed to cook the spaghetti right and sent it out, along with the risotto. Unfortunately, Ramsay found the risotto to be ugly as hell. And when he tasted it, well... Colleen, you've certainly had a lot of red flags, but at this point, I would have thrown in a white flag. That's an embarrassing amount of mistakes for one night. Trust me, I would have given up long, long ago. Don't know if that says more about her resolve or mine. Anyway, Ramsay said that hers was the worst risotto that he had ever had the displeasure of tasting. Like, it was sickly sweet for some reason. And here's why.
I grabbed this, I thought that was salt.
Seriously, mistaking sugar for salt? Remember when I said she was a cooking instructor? And guess what? That second service was worse than the first. She was at the fish station, but who was she trying to fool with her overcooked scallops? Ramsay called Lacey to step in and demonstrate how it's done, with a heavy-handed dash of snark, of course.
Come here, you. Show me how to cook a fucking scallop. Yes, hey, by the way, she's not charging $300. Hey, this is free now. Free lessons. Stand back.
Now, on to the main course. Ramsay spotted another slip-up almost immediately. Colleen forgot to send out the John Dory for an order. And that wasn't the end of it. Her salmon ended up being a double whammy, blackened at the bottom and raw in the middle. At this point, Ramsay had enough. And oh, he went straight for it.
You're not a cookery school teacher, are you? You're joking, aren't you?
No, I am not joking, Chef.
Why don't some of you guys get together with me and sign up for classes? I mean, just out of curiosity. Take notes, since you'd probably become a master if you did the opposite of everything she told you. Anyway. Don't go away yet, because Ramsay isn't done.
You don't really have a cooking school.
No, Chef, I own a cooking school. I have a business just like you do.
Your business is not like my business.
Mic drop. Wonder how her students felt watching her go up in flames like that. Ramsay clearly had a lot to say about it anyway.
You're a thief!
In the fifth episode, Colleen didn't face elimination nominations by her team. But when Ramsay had Jay and Andrea step back, he called her down and eliminated her, thanks to pretty much everything we talked about here and more. Imagine how bad you have to be to get that kind of special treatment.
But she wasn't a disaster. It's time for her to go back to where she belongs, teaching, because she certainly can't cook.
But here comes a moment that's been immortalized by HK fans.
You do seriously surprise me. Thank you, Chef.
Just like Ben, we were fooled too, weren't we? Or maybe at least I was. I mean, Ramsay totally had me in the first half. And then he dropped this.
You surprise me to how shit you are.
Thank you.
The ah you just heard was the last bit of his soul attempting to escape. And the way the camera zoomed in on Craig's face, trying to hold his laughter in, priceless. No matter how many times I've watched this, it still gets me. And poor Ben had absolutely no clue what was coming for him. He just stood there thinking he was getting praised.
I was hoping you'd see that. I mean, I'd give it all I got.
Damn, he took the bait, didn't he? Not that he had my sympathy, though. He sucked to the core. Dude had zero hygiene standards. He was chewing tobacco and leaving his spit cups all over the kitchen, and when Christina confronted him about the mess he was leaving behind, this is how he responded.
Please don't cry.
Well, I don't leave tampons on the sink.
Please.
So don't leave your nasty-ass tobacco spit in the kitchen.
He had a point, and all Ben had was an attitude. When he went to clean up, Roseanne stepped in and pointed out that he was also leaving his dirty dishes in the sink without washing them. Hey, just like my roommate. Anyway, to make her point, she mentioned that even her kids wouldn't do that. This led to a heated argument between the two, and well, Ben's response proved that he was indeed a child. Or, given what Roseanne said, worse than a child.
You guys get in the fucking kitchen and get these fucking dishes out of here. I ain't fucking cleaning them up again.
I think Ramsay's spice was pretty mild when he called him out.
Punk. Useless.
I mean, who is this guy? He couldn't even fry onion rings properly. I'm talking about the family night dinner service. After a less than average performance, he was just chilling out as he gave kudos to Bobby and Matt. But Ramsay quickly brought him back to reality, sternly pointing out that the men had 6 tickets left compared to the women who only had 2. It was high time the boys stepped up their game. And finally, when members of the red team came to assist the blue team, Ramsay took a dig at him, saying this.
Stand next to Chef Ben, yes?
All right.
Cook with him.
Gee, that was humiliating as hell. What's more, Ramsay didn't even stop there.
Give a big round of applause to the captain hitting an iceberg on the fucking Titanic.
Ramsay is truly the king of one-liners, isn't he? But hey, do you remember when this went down?
This fucking pigeon's that raw it can still fly.
Well, that juicy remark was directed towards the executive chef, Tavon. During his first and only dinner service, Tavon found himself at the appetizer station, working alongside Guy and Royce. Things took a nosedive when he sent up a plate of raw pigeon. Ramsay, clearly not pleased, quipped that it could still take flight. Royce wasn't holding back either and called Tavon out.
He's just a fucking moron.
Ramsay couldn't believe what he was seeing, and he even questioned if Tavon was genuinely an executive chef. And Patrick didn't mince his words either, pointing out the collision course Tavon was on. As if that wasn't enough, a whole new can of chaos opened up. Ramsay slammed Justin's undercooked scallops, and it turned out they were brutally sliced by none other than Tavon!
Look at these. Expensive hand-dived scallops.
God, I don't think he could have sabotaged things any worse if he was actually trying to sink the whole team on purpose. Patrick pointed out how he mutilated them. Clemenza added that they were butchered with a paperclip. But what Brian said really takes the cake.
Tavon treated those scallops like a homeless rat.
Yeah, he wasn't exaggerating one bit. And Ramsay was clearly fuming. I mean, more than an hour into the dinner service and the blue team hadn't sent out a single appetizer, I'd be mad too.
Are you executive chef? Do you actually cook in your restaurant?
Ramsay demanded to know why Tavon was delivering such a terrible performance, and Tavon's response? Well, check this out.
I guess I froze, I mean.
You froze?
Tavon was completely clueless, but Ramsay wasn't buying it and shot right back.
You haven't even fucking defrosted.
Tavon had the audacity to chuckle, which only fueled Ramsay's rage further. And that's when he gave Tavon the boot, sending him out of the kitchen and back to the dorms. Tavon's exit didn't come without commotion, though. He claimed it was his first time getting kicked out of a kitchen and dropped some colorful language about Ramsay.
This was the first time I've ever been kicked out of the kitchen in my career. Chef Ramsay, you're a fucking douchebag.
Needless to say, he was eliminated that day. After the show, he started a cooking school named Celebrity Chef Tave. And surprise, surprise, it got mostly one-star reviews. Hey, at least he's in good company with Colleen. Some claim that they would have gotten more direction from an amateur YouTube video. And the dude even ghosted a ton of them. Yeah, apparently after they booked and showed up to class, he didn't even bother showing his face. What's more, none of them received any cancellation email or refund. A pretty elaborate scam, if you ask me. Anyway, moving on, here's a guide to surviving Hell's Kitchen. 1. Don't undercook scallops. 2. Don't overcook Wellingtons. 3. Don't talk back to Ramsay. And 4. Definitely don't exaggerate your abilities. Seriously, no pie-in-the-sky ideas. But Joy didn't get the memo. During her first dinner service, she decided to go all in and told Ramsay she can work her magic on a lobster in just 45 seconds. But Ramsay wasn't convinced. In a super funny twist, he whipped out his watch and started the countdown. Time was ticking away as Joy started to fumble.
Jesus Christ! Why are they all broken? What the fuck have you done?
Meanwhile, Ramsay watched on, smug as hell. Not surprisingly, Joy's super bold claims didn't really pan out. Ramsay mocked her about it too. Which is normal for our guy Ramsay, but you gotta see how he did it.
Expensive hand-dived scallop.
Eventually, she was kicked out along with Sandra and Nicole. Wondering why? Let's rewind. So Joy was teamed up with Nicole at the fish station, and things were off to a rocky start. First up, there was confusion over who was in charge of the scallops. Nicole seemed unsure, but Joy reminded her they were on fish duty. Yet, Nicole got a bit nervous, and even forgot an order in the process. So, Joy took the reins on the fish station to avoid babysitting. But, oops, she sent out overcooked scallops.
Every time you f*** up scallops, I gotta refire a whole f***ing zone. You know how long that takes?
As they tried to fix the mess with their first table, Joy asked Nicole for help. Later, Joy found out Nicole's scallops were messed up on one side. Together, they desperately tried to get things back on track, but Nicole was slow and almost on the verge of giving up, much to Ramsay's annoyance.
If you don't put any effort into it, do me a favor, take that apron off and f*** off home.
Yes, chef.
Communication trouble hit hard. Joy and Sandra couldn't seem to get on the same page about the scallops' timing. That's when Joy took matters into her own hands and started searing the scallops without even asking Sandra first. Ramsay caught wind of this and accused Joy of giving up. She denied it, but struggled to repeat Ramsay's order back to him and ended up in tears. Sandra wasn't exactly sympathetic, and neither was Rochelle when she tried to calm Joy down. The drama escalated as Sandra refused to communicate, leaving Joy frustrated. An argument broke out, and Jessica compared it to this. Ramsay actually had to step in and put an end to the squabbling by telling both Joy and Sandra to put their differences aside and just talk to each other. It's honestly quite cringeworthy to see grown adults like Joy and Sandra getting into heated arguments like they're back in kindergarten. It's just so damn embarrassing, you guys. Despite that, trouble kept brewing as Sandra walked the risotto without telling Joy or Nicole beforehand. Nicole told her to drop the lobster tail, and Ramsay, not thrilled, called all three of them to the front. He asked, how long would it take to cook a lobster tail? And that's when Joy made that big, bold, very believable claim. And the rest is history. But here comes another contestant whose annoying and argumentative nature would be her undoing. In the very first episode of season 8, Ramsay caught Sabrina Brimmel yawning loudly. Of course, he called her out for just being bored. But from there on, it got serious. Ramsay even hinted at sending her home right then and there. He even made her sit down in a chair, which is kind of unusual in a busy kitchen like HK. And then bestowed her with a brand new nickname.
Sit down and rest your weary legs. Thank you, Baby Spice. You look very cozy there.
She was young, but let's not pretend we never saw two chefs in their early 20s not having a better attitude than this entitled brat.
Would you like a drink?
No, thank you, chef.
You sure?
I'm okay.
Felt like Ramsay was saying she wasn't fully into it, even though everyone else was working hard. But did Sabrina give a damn?
I don't care. I'm not scared of you, Chef Ramsay. I'm not.
Man, she was still so disrespectful, despite being mocked in front of all the other contestants during her very first challenge. But here comes Sabrina Gressett from season 6. Not nearly as obnoxious as her season 8 namesake, but still had her own share of embarrassing moments. During the dinner service, Sabrina was holding down the fort at the meat station. About an hour and a half into the hustle, she confidently announced her chicken was ready to roll. But in the time-honored HK tradition, it turned out it was still raw. A quick change of plans was in order, so she popped it back in the pan. While she was tackling that mess, Suzanne, perhaps a bit too eager to help, was giving her pointers. Sabrina didn't take kindly to the interference. Tensions ran high, and a heated argument flared up between the two. Sabrina didn't hold back, telling Suzanne to zip it so she could get her work done.
Just shut up for 1 minute. I got it.
Fast forward just a minute, and guess what? Sabrina sends her chicken to the pass, despite Suzanne's warning that it was still undercooked.
Pinker than your fucking lipstick!
Yes, chef.
Later, Ramsay swung by again and noticed Sabrina's chicken had done a 180, and now it was crispy and burnt. That was the last straw for Ramsay. He'd had enough and ordered both teams to whip up shrimp cocktails for the diners, especially targeting her.
Nothing seasoned, crushed ice in a glass with ketchup.
Facing the music, Sabrina surprisingly owned up to the mess.
Let's go, shrimp cocktails, let's go.
Yeah, you bet it was. However, once the shrimp cocktails were done, Ramsay had seen enough. He shut down both kitchens, putting an end to the chaotic dinner service. Fast forward to episode 8, and Sabrina had her hands full managing the meat station once again. However, things got a bit messy as Suzanne chimed in again, announcing her fish was ready when Sabrina was still waiting for her entrees to be cooked for another 4 minutes. Why couldn't they coordinate better as a team? Anyway, somehow Sabrina did manage to send out her lamb dish to the dining room, But there was a problem.
What? Yes, not cooked.
Fucking hell.
Yeah, the lamb turned out bloody and rare. Definitely not what the diner had in mind, since they weren't like a werewolf or something. And Jean-Philippe had to bring it right back. This understandably got Ramsay quite upset. He accused Sabrina of sending out undercooked food on purpose. What's more, he decided to give her a taste of her own medicine.
Inconsistent, dry lamb on the outside, raw in the center, fuck off and eat it!
Can you imagine how utterly embarrassing it must have felt to sit out and eat her shame in front of the patrons? However, chefs getting put in timeout or forced to eat their mistakes are certainly not rare in this competition. Remember Chino from season 9?
Get out of my sight.
Sit down.
Scott, get him peeling onions, garlic, but away from the stove.
After he brought burnt miso cod to the pass, Ramsay benched him at the chef's table, giving him some garlic to prep. Dude may as well have gotten kicked out. Then there was Siobhan's, "My scallops are fine," from season 7. Siobhan was in the zone, focusing on her scallop order. However, things went sideways when she was told to redo an order. And then, to everyone's surprise, Ramsay found a whole bunch of boiled scallops. When questioned, she decided to fire back.
"You thought they looked golden brown."
But not even her teammates could back her up on this one. But nothing could change Siobhan's mind. For her, her scallops were the very definition of perfection. That really got Ramsay's gears grinding. He had to literally break down exactly what was wrong with the scallops.
"Seasoned, and you know what, more importantly, they're boiled."
I guess she should have listened to Nilka.
"Keep your mouth shut, yes, chef, and cook. Don't talk, because he's only gonna put his foot deeper, yeah."
But Siobhan was still so defensive. So just like that, he kicked her out of the kitchen, sending her straight to the dining room to own up to her blunder.
"Get out, off the bar and eat it."
And Chef Ramsay has sent her to the dining room to eat.
She couldn't live up to her last name because turns out nothing was all good. Her life outside the show proved that much and more. Her friend organized fundraising on her behalf because, get this, she was left homeless after HK. According to the update, she started fashion designing, gave up her house, and sold everything to take up a job in LA, making accessories for a friend's company. Unfortunately, that friendship deteriorated, and she lost both her housing and job without any notice. Reading this gave me chills. She was even subjected to an attack, narrowly escaping an attempted sexual assault. Fortunately, she managed to escape and reported the incident to the police. Hope she's doing better now. If anybody has an update, be sure to let me know in the comments down below. No matter how many times you screw up on Hell's Kitchen, nobody deserves that kind of lot in life. Anyway, if you think I missed your favorite moment from the show, drop that in the comments too. Many have speculated that Ramsay's softening over the years could be attributed to factors like age, family, or his experiences working with amateur cooks and even kids on shows like MasterChef and MasterChef Junior. However, a more straightforward explanation might be the changing dynamics of television and societal norms.
"Missy, Missy, come here, you fat mouth little sh**."
About 2 decades ago, Ramsay could say things that, by today's standards, would not fly on television. Things like calling women cows or b****s or making comments about people being overweight was far more acceptable back then.
"Times 3, Amanda."
Nine.
Nowadays, such abusive language for the sake of entertainment or some cheap laughs would certainly face a lot of backlash on social media. And I definitely don't disagree with that being the way things should be. But more pragmatically, getting canceled means huge financial losses for Gordon Ramsay's brand. I guess if societal deterrents aren't working, you could always follow the money. But over the years, the show has a troubling legacy of normalizing some of these forms of abuse. It's not all bad, but when it is bad, it's real bad. And hey, shout out to Tennille for being one of the only contestants who stood their ground and had the guts to question Ramsay's bullying.
"Petition, but you can't take it!
Hey, madam!"
But not everyone had the nerve to stand up to him. Not even most people. Like in the final 6 dinner service in season 5. Giovanni was at the meat station. However, his habit of constantly opening and closing the convection oven didn't go unnoticed, and Ramsay warned him about potential consequences later on.
You told me you open it at 30 seconds.
Yes, chef.
Let's go, huh? And I mean move, yes?
When it came time to deliver, Gio's execution of Ben's chicken special was a disaster. A raw drumstick landed on the plate.
I had to refire a chicken. I had him in the oven for a long time, but then they start to burn.
He admitted to his mistake and requested a minute for a do-over. Despite the setback, Ben remained optimistic, believing that if Gio executed the next time around, he'd salvage the situation. Unfortunately, Gio's second attempt wasn't much better. It was cooked, sure, but it was practically torn to pieces by the time Gio was finished with it. And yeah, Ramsay was far from happy.
It's now become not very special, thanks to face there. Hurry up, Giovanni!
But when Gio pretty reasonably told him to knock it off with the face label, Ramsay only got more furious.
But I'm not the face chef.
Yeah, say that again?
Fair enough, I guess. But it escalated to the extent that Ramsay started screaming in Gio's face. If more shitty chicken hit the pass, Gio would be hitting the road. In the end, Ramsay reassigned Ben to the meat station to assist Giovanni with his struggling special. Maybe Ben would be able to get his own special right. 2 hours into the dinner service, Andrea was frustrated that Giovanni had gone all but radio silent. And when he did speak, his stuttering only made it harder for Robert and Andrea to understand it. But I mean, the guy was flustered. And Ramsay was just being unnecessarily aggressive here. The situation got really bad when Robert had to restart, and then restart again. In no small part because of Gio going mute. This prompted Ramsay to gather all three chefs together before putting Gio on blast. It's kind of funny how he yelled, "Face, this is professional!" right in Giovanni's face. I mean, who knew that not wanting to be called a face at work was unprofessional?
Face.
I'm an emotional person, but he can get my face all he wants.
Right? Did anyone else feel like Ramsay totally blew that whole thing out of proportion? I mean, I'm used to him losing it over mediocre food, but when he dropped the face bomb on Gio, and he fired back with a simple, "I'm not a face chef," I didn't see it as backtalk or disrespect. To me, it seemed like Gio was trying to hype himself back up. But I don't know. What's your take? Let me know in the comments. Now, there's this one moment that I felt like the show hit rock bottom. I'm talking about the Hell's Kitchen 3K from season 11. Ramsay picked Mary to lead the race, even though others on her team actually volunteered.
Mary, come on down, Mary, let's go.
Well, she was honest about being out of shape, but hoped to make up for it somehow. Anyway, the race kicked off, and she was clearly slower, considering she was bringing up the rear. But she finally managed to hit a checkpoint, letting Cindy finally breathe a sigh of relief. But the race was far from over, and she was still pushing herself when the others were already hitting the dining room. By the time she arrived, the service was already in full swing, and Mary was seriously wiped out. She asked for a quick catch-up, considering she found it in her to run the whole course, despite how fit she was. In my opinion, Mary deserved a bit more understanding than she got.
Where's Mary?
I mean, I don't know what Ramsay was trying to prove by choosing her. It kind of felt like something that the worst, most petty high school gym teacher would try doing. But this situation also reminds me of something that happened in season 5. The blue team clinched the scallop cleaning challenge with a narrow 36-35 victory, earning them a sweet reward, a helicopter tour of Catalina Island, and a submarine ride. Exciting stuff, right? Well, not for Robert. Before the celebration could kick in, Ramsay called him over, delivering a blow that the helicopter insurance wouldn't allow anyone over 300 pounds. With Robert well over 100 pounds over the limit, he had to settle for a ferry ride to the island. Kind of a shame not to soar over the open ocean.
And we're all going back? Yes? Okay.
You can't help but feel sorry for him. But I mean, what's a ferry ride in the grand scheme of things? If it means the real part of the reward was still waiting for him. Unfortunately, by the time he finally reached the island, the reward was already done and dusted. This left him with just a complimentary round-trip ferry ride, while his teammates enjoyed the full experience. I mean, sure, the dude was heavy, but that doesn't diminish his worth as a person. Could they not arrange for another helicopter or something? Or, you know, wait for him? It honestly felt more like a punishment than a reward, and believe me, no one enjoys seeing someone get screwed out of a reward. Now, let's talk about what happened in Season 8, Episode 6, when the Salad Challenge winner Rob scored a chance to grace the cover of Bon Appetit magazine alongside Ramsay. Now, this is where things get a bit sour. The guest judge, not Ramsay, picked Rob as the victor. But at the photo shoot, it was crystal clear that Ramsay wasn't thrilled about sharing the limelight with Rob.
A lot of fat ones, too.
To make things worse, he tossed a series of weight-related insults Rob's way.
Make Rob look like 95 pounds.
Man, what is it with this guy and weight? I know he takes fitness seriously, but cut everyone else some slack. I love working out, but I don't belittle people that don't. The Chosen magazine cover had Ramsay and the Bon Appetit lady front and center, while poor Rob was hidden behind a chair. But weight isn't the only issue. Ramsay can come across as harsh, especially towards shorter chefs as well. And I'm not gonna get through a video like this without coming to defend my short kings. Eddie from Season 3 got a pretty brutal send-off with a off from Ramsay, which felt unnecessarily cruel. Even the worst chefs usually get a bit of respect on their way out.
Yes, sir.
And then there's Craig from Season 4, the guy with the giant chef's hat. Ramsay was constantly on his ass, too.
Small boy syndrome downstairs.
Okay.
Absolutely unnecessary.
You come down to my kitchen again with a ridiculous hat on like that.
I mean, can we just be a little more empathetic towards people's insecurities and not make fun of them, especially when you're putting them on blast for the world to see? Eddie, being 5'2" due to being born without kidneys, already had a tough situation, and the constant teasing about his height just sucks to see.
Eddie is a small guy, and I'm not sure when he can come out of that ship.
Eddie didn't choose to be born the way he was, and using it as a weapon against him just doesn't sit right with me. At least, maybe focus more on his cooking skills, like how he does with literally everyone else. Moving on. Every time Ramsay slams food on someone's body, yeah, it pisses me off. And this happened on the very first episode of the show. Talk about setting the tone. After Ralph and Jeff handled their initial tables, Ralph submitted his first order to Ramsay. However, only Michael responded to Ramsay's call, and the rest of the team just sort of awkwardly stood around.
That was absolutely pathetic. A call out the first ticket, the big excitement.
Meanwhile, Jeff found himself in a bit of a pickle, unsure whether he should hand his ticket to Jean-Philippe or Ramsay. Jean-Philippe clarified that it should go directly to Ramsay.
And leave the ticket on top.
Yeah. No, you need to give it
Give me the fucking ticket.
Over in the Red Kitchen, Elsie was eager to earn Ramsay's approval, but her aspirations took a hit when her risotto turned out overcooked. So much so that it was practically glued to the plate. Ramsay theatrically waved the dish around, and not a single grain budged. So into the trash it went.
What is that? I can't, come on, fucking hell.
I'm down.
And Elsie looked nervously around before quietly starting over. 1 hour into the service, not a single dish had left the kitchen. Ralph's table was getting restless, and he was trying his best to figure out how long it would take to get food over there. Over in the Blue Kitchen, Michael ran out of lobster spaghetti, but Ramsay brushed off the issue, stating that as long as they had live lobsters and pasta, there was no reason to remove it from the menu. Michael promptly rushed to the back store to go grab the ingredients.
So why'd we have to take it off?
We don't, chef.
Yeah, that's a sign of a lazy restaurant.
When Ralph's table finally made their way up to the kitchen to express their frustration with the wait, Ramsay's response was far from accommodating. He bluntly told them to shut up and instructed the blue team to ignore the situation, referring to the guests as...
We just get them all up top and all.
Let's go. Just ignore these bimbos.
I think Ramsay gets away with a lot of stuff simply because he's Gordon Ramsay. Like calling your guests bimbos. If it were me, I'd definitely walk out right then and there. But the ladies found it within themselves to go back to their table. An hour and 20 minutes into the service, some of the red diners were already digging into their appetizers and moving on to entrees. However, things took a nosedive when Chris sent up an overcooked salmon. And so Ramsay did the obvious thing, smacked the fish against Chris's chest, scolding him for sending it when he knew it was messed up, and ordering him to redo the entire table.
It's a little fucked up, so.
Don't do it again, okay?
Yeah, if you didn't get my sarcasm, one of those things was not like the others. Chris, seemingly unfazed, believed Ramsay would come around eventually. Meanwhile, Jimmy took a more confrontational route, calling Ramsay insane and vowing not to let the chef treat him like garbage.
That's insane. I'm not about to take shit from Gordon. I'm not a piece of garbage.
Fair enough, I guess. However, when Jimmy sent up a dish of his own, Ramsay did the exact same thing he did with Chris.
Then you want to walk away winning a restaurant? Fuck yourself. Get in the bin.
I mean, it was bad for sure, but do we really need to start throwing things? Anyway, 2 hours into the dinner service, things were going way worse than Ramsay had expected. Both teams were struggling to get appetizers out, and the entrees were quickly becoming a pie-in-the-sky dream. In the midst of it all, Andrew decided to provoke Ramsay by asking if the dessert he made was acceptable. Ramsay didn't hold back, facing Andrew and making it clear he wasn't about to leave the hot plate to check on a dessert of all things. He told Andrew that if he had questions, he needed to come down to the hot plate himself. And Andrew boldly challenged Ramsay to pick on him.
I'm trying to run the hot plate here, so would you be so kind to come and talk to me? Is that clear?
Over in the red kitchen, Elsie made a comeback by sending a second risotto to redeem herself, successfully catching Ramsay's attention and sensing he acknowledged her determination. On the other hand, Jimmy's meat station was practically in ruins, but he hoped to follow Elsie's lead in spite of it. However, he was so flustered that he grabbed some lamb from the oven with his bare hands, which obviously sent him straight to the medic.
I had to go get a lamb instead of grabbing tongue.
And trust me, Ramsay was intent on kicking everyone while they were down.
Jimmy weighs 250 pounds. He's never going to make a great chef because he's too clumsy.
Later, Elsie noticed Carillon seemingly doing nothing but watching. Ramsay also took notice and called Carillon over to assist, but this didn't sit well with her.
I wish I were Superwoman, knew everybody's stations. Chef Ramsay just really made me angry.
When Jimmy returned from the medic, Ramsay, you guessed it, showed zero sympathy whatsoever.
Screw up so many bits of meat in one service.
Meanwhile, Jeff attempted to make it up to his tables for the wait. But Ramsay shut him down when he went to the hot plate to submit another order. Then, Ramsay's eponymous bimbos attempted to return to the kitchen. But Ramsay shut them down even harder this time.
Jean-Philippe Souffle, can you escort these two ladies, please? Back to plastic surgery.
Ladies, please.
Oh boy, here we go. Well, as both kitchens finally received approval to send out entrees, customers fed up with the wait walked out, and with no customers, there wasn't much of a point to keeping the kitchen open. As the blue team cleaned up, Ralph called the night what it was. Ugly for both sides. Meanwhile, Andrew felt that he had given his all that night. What a way to kick off an entirely new show, huh? Anyway, moving on. If you remember, Vinny was holding down the garnish station in his third service in season 3. But it wasn't long before he royally screwed up the scallops. But instead of addressing the issue professionally, or even loud but constructive, Ramsay's specialty, he took an unorthodox approach. He picked up a stray raw egg and decided to smash it on Vinny's chest.
What is that?
I've got to say, I've got zero justification for Ramsay's behavior there. I mean, as if smearing cooked food all over Chef's chest wasn't enough. Raw stuff? Like, come on. And by the way, Ramsay also unnecessarily kicked out a chef who didn't deserve to be kicked out in the first place. I'm talking about season 11, episode 9. Yeah, if you know, you know. But if not, let me get you up to speed. As the first customers entered, Cindy was trying her best to play nice with Susan. Meanwhile, Nedra sent out her appetizers, but Mary forgot to drop the slider.
I've called out the slider already. Why is it not on?
I didn't hear you, Chef. I'm sorry, Chef.
Ramsay questioned Mary about it, but she didn't hear him initially. Despite Mary's assurance to fix it, Ramsay wasn't pleased. So the women had to restart the ticket. Eventually, Nedra and Mary managed to send their dishes to the pass, all of which were accepted. However, they also unknowingly sent up some hair with a customer's slider.
Chef, I'm sorry. There's a hair in between a burger.
Yeah, things were about to get ugly. Especially when Jean-Philippe brought it to Ramsay's attention.
God almighty, fucking hair!
Refire urgently!
Mary was determined to salvage her reputation after the hair incident, and fortunately, Ramsay accepted her next slider, sans hair. Crisis averted. As they transitioned to entrees, Susan took charge, presenting her prime rib that she had just taken out of the convection oven. As Susan went to the dining room to serve it, Jacqueline and Amanda were idle at the meat station, waiting for Susan to finish slicing. When Jacqueline informed Ramsay that they were waiting for Susan, he called the entire team down. Susan thought she might be praised for Jacqueline's skills. However, Ramsay had something else in mind.
How long?
We're waiting for Susan.
No, you f*** you.
Do you notice what's wrong here again? Over an hour into service, the women faced Ramsay's wrath for halting progress on their entrees before reorganizing themselves.
Entrees? Did you tell her to stop?
No.
Oh, really?
Susan, returning to the dining room, shared what was going on with a customer. Maybe not the best move, but Jacqueline eventually followed up with perfect steak dishes, so... However, chaos ensued when Mary announced her sea bass was ready. But Amanda still needed 4 minutes. Frustrated, Mary escalated the issue to Ramsay, saying she had warned them ahead of time. But Amanda completely refuted that.
I told them, Chef.
Did she tell you that?
No, Chef.
And when Jacqueline sent her filet mignon, it turned out raw. Ramsay got on both Jacqueline and Amanda's cases for botching the easiest cut of meat.
Raw filet, the easiest to cook, cold and raw.
Amanda regretted trusting Jacqueline, and Jacqueline vowed never to trust anyone ever again. This is when Nedra stepped in to help the two of them. So let's hope they figure out how to trust Nedra. As Ramsay called for another filet mignon, Amanda claimed to be checking on it, but apparently it was 1 minute too few. Or, well, five. So it seems pretty fair that the three were kicked out of the kitchen. But they brought an unwilling stowaway with them.
You, fuck off, all four of you. Get out!
Yeah, Cindy. And boy, was she mad about it.
You're kicking me out because Jacqueline and Amanda can't cook a freaking filet?
And I'm completely with her on this one. She was done dirty. Like, rewind to the start of this section. Guess how many times I've talked about her so far. Yup, that was literally the only time I mentioned her. She also had a small cameo earlier in the video. Let me know if you managed to find it. Anyway, Amanda and Jacqueline were the ones who were really behind those raw steaks. And Ramsay came in from the top rope and completely bodied Cindy out of nowhere. Totally unfair. But what do you think? Go ahead and let me know in the comments. I know I miss stuff sometimes, but I really don't think I missed anything with Cindy this time around. But please, keep me honest. And if you enjoy my videos, don't forget to check out my social media pages to keep up with me. And show your support by leaving a like, subscribing, and turning on my post notifications so you don't miss a thing. Also, make sure to check out the next video right here. It's even better.